She's a Juno Award-winning CBC National Radio host, spectacular piano player, singer-songwriter, who's played everywhere from Carnegie Hall to Beijing's National Center for the Performing Arts. And when Sting needed to work out a song, he emailed Laila Biali, knowing she was the one who could take it next level. Laila feels called by God to work in music with her husband and young son. And she gives her art and her heart to God. She says there's an inner driving force within and without she returns to time and again to sustain her. Her latest album, Out of Dust, features multiple Grammy winners, including Lisa Fisher, Alan Ferber, and John Lewis, to name just a few. Today on The Perspective with Mike Sherbino and Julie Stautland, Mike teaches on how all of our gifts are significant, and international jazz great and Canadian treasure Laila Biali knows this firsthand.
Hey, have you ever thought about what it means to live life on purpose? Oh, welcome to The Perspective today. And as we're dealing with this whole overarching theme of the church being on mission, I want to talk about your mission. Let me read to you from an old book. It was written by Rick Warren. It's called The Purpose-Driven Life. He says, the purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, or even your happiness, and is far greater than your family or your career. If you want to know why you're placed on this planet, you must begin with God. You're born by His purpose and for His purpose. And as we talk about purpose, Julie, I'm glad you're with us today to talk to us a little bit about the program and a special guest we have.
Yes, stay with us. We have the amazing Laila Biali with us right after the break. It's so wonderful to have her here today to share her heart being on purpose.
I'm super excited today to have Laila Biali with us today. You probably know all her accolades. Some of the things is not only being a Juno Award winner, but playing with Sting and Chris Botti. Now, Laila, I want to welcome you today. My wife would just be totally amped to know that you have played with Chris Botti. But, you know, apart from that, God has just been using you to mark your own trajectory. And we're excited as Canadians as we watch you. And thank you for coming on the program today.
Oh, thank you for having me, Mike. It's such a pleasure to be here.
You know, that word trajectory is kind of interesting. We've been going through COVID. We've got the ups and downs. But as a musician, that's a unique challenge in trying to keep your feet on the ground when your head is in the clouds. How have you handled the ups and downs in your career?
Well, whether it's in pandemic times or through early motherhood, moving across international borders, I think it boils down to the word call. And pandemic has never put my career kind of under fire or in the crucible. It really did that more than any other experience in my life. And there were moments, and I've been asked this in other interviews, where I thought, I don't know if I can do this anymore, because it made an already difficult career that much more so. But then when I would take times to reflect, and if you looked at kind of various criteria, Mike, it made no sense to proceed. No sense. But then I would come back to that place of prayer and reflection and inquiry in a way, saying, God, what is it you would have me continue to do? And it just kept coming back to that call to be, to write and to perform and to share music, even when it feels like it makes no sense to do so.
You know, as you talk about that, you're living with two tensions. You talk about coming back to God, you're a follower of Jesus, and that's exciting. But on the other hand, you're with other people who maybe share different beliefs. So take us to the other extreme, working with people like Sting or Chris Botti, and how do you handle that when there is so much fame and stardom, and yet you still have to come home and be a mom and a wife and all those good things?
Well, I think I see us all as seekers in this world. Do you know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. and so in my view, Sting and Chris are no different. The path might look a little bit different, but there are so many ways in which we connect. And I've just always felt like, and this can sound so cliche, Mike, but I just always feel like no matter what we do, no matter what our vocation, our job and the call is to love. So of course I spoke about call earlier in relation or in regards to who I am as a musician, but even beyond that is the call to love and to reflect and embody God's love. And so whether I'm on tour with Chris or Sting or playing my own music or sweeping the floors or getting my son to school, you know, the call is to love. And what's beautiful is that nobody is exempt from that.
You know, as you share that, that really warms my heart, because I think that's what draws people to you, to listen to you. There's such a genuineness. And yet it's so easy to lose sight of that. It's so easy for that to go out the window. And regardless of what we're doing, whether we're on TV or radio or you name it, you've got an interesting connection, and I told you I have a terrible sense of humor, but now I'm dead serious, okay? I'm dead serious. Okay. I always, you know, when I start churches, I ask people to come and help me. So I'd like you to come and help me, but I really want your husband to come because I'm looking for a really solid drummer, okay? So you can be the sidekick. No, seriously.
I'd love to be Benny's sidekick.
Tell me about that relationship. Where did you guys meet, and how does that work together as two professional musicians?
Oh, it's wonderful. I mean, we've had a complicated history. We met playing in Paula Cole's band way back when. Ben is 17 years older than I am, so he's another generation. And we met in New York at Euphoria Studios back in 2007. And there was immediately a connection, but little did we know what the future had in store for us. And we've been together now for over 12 years, and we do everything together, and thank goodness we really like each other. Like, we don't just love one another, but we actually really like each other, and it's a very fruitful working relationship as well. As you mentioned, he's an amazing drummer and producer, and I would be thrilled to hitch my wagon to his, so you can have him, Mike, as long as I can come along.
Well, listen, I understand that you have what was I going to call him? Not a producer, but you have a new manager, and that's your son. So how does that all fit in?
That's fantastic. Have you been a fly on the wall of the Biali Whitman household? I think you have, because you're absolutely right. Josh is in charge.
Yeah.
It's a balance. It's a balance. Josh is a beautiful and sensitive young boy and, well, growing boy. And so we find that just when we found our groove, we have to be ready to pivot, pandemic notwithstanding, you know, and so, you know, he really keeps us checking in with one another and checking in with God, as we should as parents, just to make sure that we're ordering our steps in our lives as best serves Josh within our family trio.
You know, in a couple of minutes, Julie's going to come on and ask you some more skill testing questions. How do you juggle the priorities, family, career, your walk with God? How do you juggle that?
Not all that well. I mean, honestly, I feel like how I'm behaving on a day-to-day basis or even moment-by-moment basis is a good barometer of how much I'm checking in with God and spending time in reflection and prayer. Because the moment those things are not in their right place, things get out of whack. So that's a huge priority, is that reflective time and time in prayer.
I love what you shared. You know what? I want to invite our listeners just to stay with us. We're going to be right back as Julie's going to ask Laila some more interesting questions that I know are going to help connect you as you are unpacking your purpose for which you are living your life.
Laila, I am so excited to have you here today. We're focusing on mission and how God loves artists. And I have to say that my own daughter, Trinity, is a singer-songwriter and a fine arts student. And she's in school right now in Sweden. And actually, this is some of her very early art right behind me. But I wanted to ask you right off the top, what advice would you give her today as an up-and-comer in this biz, especially as a young Christian woman in the music?
That's a big question. It is. And she is from another generation. And I'm doing my best as someone who's now 41 to keep up with how the industry is moving and changing. And so in many ways, what I would say to encourage Trinity from a business perspective is that she is almost better positioned than someone like myself to really thrive in the music biz, because it's a lot about how artists share who they are on online spaces, like it or not. Mm-hmm. So TikTok, right. Instagram, you know, whatever new fangled social media site I've not heard of. but then I would say that there's a vulnerability that comes with that. And there have been a lot of conversations, even with like social media experts that talk about the pressures that come with a life kind of lived online, or where we post so much of ourselves right. online. And as an artist, you know, it can be tricky to find the balance between what you really authentically want to share and what you feel is being demanded of you, or what is trending.
Right.
And so while I think it's smart and good to pay attention to trends, I would encourage Trinity to return time and time again to her well, wherever she needs to go to have her cup refilled, so she can be inspired and stay true to the call, and then write, create, and share from that place.
I love that. Return to the well. I mean, that's great for every artist. And I think even no matter what career we're involved in, we all as Christians need to return to the well. I think that's so well said. How has COVID impacted your performances, your writing, and life in general? And I want to add that, you know, in this time with everyone going through COVID and the pandemic and things going on in the world, we really need artists. We need that gift that God has given artists to be able to encourage us. So with that big calling, how has it impacted you, this COVID pandemic, and what you've been going through?
Well, thank you for saying that, because I think artists in many ways have felt relegated to the sidelines during pandemic. And so it's just really meaningful to hear others say, we need you. We need you now more than ever.
Right.
And I mean, I would agree, of course, I'm biased, but it's been tricky, Julie. Like, I've had gigs get canceled, rescheduled, canceled again, rescheduled for the second time, canceled yet again.
Wow.
And in that sense, I'm tired.
Yeah.
But you know what? It's building resilience. And I think of the human skills that we are wise to sort of allow to have refined in our lives. Resilience is a big one. And again, in any field, but I think especially for musicians and people who are in the gig economy. But I've been lucky to get out now and then. So, you know, the world and various places around the world have moved through different periods of lockdown and then restrictions easing. And I have been fortunate to get out and play a little bit, which for me is like water, you know. That's why I do what I do. It's not because I want to write music in my own little box and then share it. I actually, for me, what makes it most meaningful is the opportunity to then connect with people live and in living color. And it's that connection that drives me. So I've missed that, but I'm glad that I've been able to enjoy it here and there, even in Florida recently in Boca Grande.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I love how art, it ministers to others But I find even as myself, as a creative person, it ministers to me as well. So as you're saying, you know, you need that yourself. It feeds your soul as much as it feeds other people's soul. And on that note, I have to say, I love the song that you do, Take Me to the Alley. Do you see Jesus in the songs you write and cover?
Sure, I do. Not always in a sort of cookie cutter way or a conventional way, whatever that means. But I think I'm drawn to artists who, I don't know, just share a different perspective on who Christ is in their life. And like, I think of Bono, I think of Bruce Coburn, you know, and certainly Gregory Porter, who I imagine as a Christian. He's the gentleman who wrote Take Me to the Alley, because the lyrics, I mean, they're incredible, right?
And, right. Absolutely.
But I actually have never met him, and I've read, you know, interviews and so on, and he did grow up in the church. So I imagine it must be coming from a faith driven place, if not a very authentic relationship. But yeah, I am certainly drawn to songs that, examine who Christ is in our lives and in our world. But again, not always in a conventional way. I would love people who don't necessarily call themselves Christian to be drawn to the music and not to feel excluded by it. That's really important to me.
Absolutely. I think that's the most important, is that they sense there's something more about the music, even though they can't always put their finger on it, but that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. I think that's incredible. Tell us about your work with CIBC, CBC Radio.
CBC has been a huge gift. I mean, goodness, I love being a host on Saturday Night Jazz. And I always say that, you know, when I perform live as an artist, I feel like I'm inviting people into my space. But when I'm a host, I feel like people are inviting me into their space when I'm on radio. And that feels very sacred to me. And then just practically, I'm so fortunate that I've had a job, a consistent job throughout pandemic, while gigs have been canceled and rebooked left and right. So CBC is a real gift in my life.
Oh, that's awesome. I want to join back with Mike. I know he's got another question for you.
You know, I feel like we're just getting warmed up. There's a lot of different questions I'd love to explore with you, but help us with maybe just giving us a snippet on one question. It's not in the script. It's not in the rundown. When you think about the word worship, what comes to your mind as a musician, as a singer, as a performer?
To me, worship, it's a word that gets attached to music, especially within the context of church. But to me, worship is everything we do at any point in the day. We are designed for worship. And actually, somebody in a pastor somewhere, I can't remember where, it might have been in New York when I was living there, talked about the words worth and shape, and the idea that when we are functionally in a place of worship, no matter what we're doing, that is actually also what gives us a true and unshakable sense of our worth. And I thought that was a really beautiful and interesting definition and an approach to kind of defining that, which is very difficult to define.
Thank you. I mean, you handle that question so well. But as we close today, tell us what's coming around the corner for you. What are some of the things you're looking forward to?
Hopefully a Christmas and Winter Songs project later this year.
I can hardly wait for Christmas. You got to come on the show and do some of the songs.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Laila, thank you so much for being with us today. It's been a privilege. We look forward to having you on again. And we wish you God's best in the next stage of the journey for you.
And so as we continue to look at this theme of living life on purpose, it was amazing for me to hear the story of Laila and how she lives on purpose, how she uses her gifts to make a difference by partnering with God. And so today I want us to take a little bit more of a step back and ask ourselves that very same question. Are we living life on purpose? Do we believe that God can partner with us to make a difference in this world as well? I'm reminded of the words that the Apostle Paul says when speaking to a group of Christians in the city of Ephesus, words that he would want us to hear today as well, as it speaks about living on purpose. Ephesians 2:10 says this, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And it's right there that we see this valuable lesson that God wants us to live on purpose by partnering with Him. But what does that look like? What does that look like for you, for me, in the midst of life, in the midst of challenges, in the midst of COVID, in the midst of obstacles? I'm reminded of one of the great miracles of Jesus. When Jesus has been teaching, he's been healing, and the crowds really won't let him get away. And so Jesus at one point turns to Philip and says, listen, we've got to do something. We have to feed these people. And so he asks Philip point blank, where shall we find food enough for all these to eat? And Philip looks at him and is like, Jesus, you've got to be kidding me. There is thousands upon thousands. There's really nothing we can do. But Philip can't say straight out no to Jesus. And so he says, listen, 8 months' wages, like a really long time it would take to get just enough food for a bite. Basically, he was saying, Jesus, this is impossible. He failed to see the opportunity to partner with Jesus. But then there's Andrew. Andrew comes along and he's found a little boy's lunch and he's almost reluctant, but he comes to Jesus and says, listen, I found this little boy's lunch, like the equivalent of like a McHappy meal today. And it's like, but what can this do amongst so many? It's right here that we learn one of the greatest lessons of if we want to live on purpose, if we want to partner with God, is are we seeing obstacles as opportunities? We just heard in that interview with Laila in the midst of COVID, in the midst of the challenges, it would be easy for her to step back, but she was reminded that she was to live on purpose and those obstacles became opportunities. And so what about you? What obstacles are there in the midst of your life that perhaps God is putting before you, not as a roadblock, but rather as an opportunity? Because John tells us in this miracle that after Jesus asked Philip, we're told that Jesus already knew what he was going to do. It was an opportunity. It was an invitation through an obstacle to live life on purpose by partnering with God. One of the reminders in my life is when I have an obstacle or a difficulty, oftentimes the first place I go to is prayer, as I'm sure you do, almost wanting to give it over to God. But have you ever considered a boomerang prayer? You know, a boomerang, you throw it out and it goes out, but then it comes back. That oftentimes in the midst of obstacles, God wants to bring it back to us as well to say, will you join me in stepping out in faith and living on purpose? Because when Andrew brought this little boy's lunch to him, something incredible happened. Jesus took the gift, as insignificant as it was. He blessed it, it distributed amongst everyone, and everyone had enough to eat, so much so there was even 12 basketfuls left over. Amazing. Which brings us to the second principle, that when we live on purpose, that when we partner with God, we'll not only see obstacles as opportunities, but we'll realize that no gift is insignificant when placed in the hands of Jesus. Andrew could have easily said, it's a boy's lunch. What difference is it going to make? And just not even bothered offering it to Jesus. But he brought it to him. I think the very same thing is true for you and for me. That we may not be well-known jazz musicians, but God has wired you to make a difference, to partner with him. And so what are the opportunities? What are the ways that you can take that step of faith? Maybe God is nudging you with an obstacle. Do you begin to see it as an opportunity? Not as something that you have to do on your own, but rather stepping out in faith, saying, God, here is the little that I have. And then allowing him to take your gift, to use your life to make a difference. One of the greatest lessons we see in the Bible is that God loves to partner with people. And when we take that step of faith, when we choose to live life on mission, recognizing that obstacles are opportunities, and that no gift is insignificant when placed in the hands of Jesus, not only are we living life on purpose, but we'll begin to see the impact that God will have on you and on those around you. This week, live life on purpose.
I don't know about you, Mike, but I don't like obstacles. So the idea of God inviting me to do something through an obstacle is like, I have to admit, I'm weak, I'm fallible, but that is exactly where he wants us. When we're weak, that's when he's able to be using us and we become the strongest. And I love Joel's message, and it just hit me in the heart and challenged me that we need to believe that God can do the impossible and to allow those opportunities, no matter how small, no matter how much we think we're insignificant, God can come through if we are willing.
Yeah, and that's the key word, isn't it, Julie? If we're willing, because it's a partnership. And we've been talking about partnership. We've been talking about living life on purpose. Mm-hmm. And as you don't like obstacles, well, guess what? Nobody else does either. But it seems, yeah, so I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for you, Julie. But here's the deal is that those become opportunities, as Joel said, for God right. to step in. And I think he's waiting for our invitation. I'm convinced of it. What about you?
Yeah, absolutely. If we're only willing to look in the mirror and go, okay, I can't do this myself. But if I surrender it to God, if I say, okay, I'm willing, I'm going to allow you to move and work through me. I'm willing to see what's possible with this body of mine and with my hands, with my feet. Okay, here you go. And you understand then that nothing is impossible with God. Wow, it just breaks open that box and we really can see how God's going to move in our lives. And he has never let me down when I allow that box to be broken, because I know that whenever I start to crouch in, that's when the ceiling comes down and I can't see God move. But wow, break open that box and God will move.
Yeah, well, that's a great word. And so as we close today, I want to encourage you just to open up your heart and say, Lord, I want to invite you into my situation, and he will come. He always is looking forward to answering that prayer. And as we wrap up today, another treat as we listen to a little bit more of Laila Biali.
Take me to the afflicted ones. Take me to the let them hear me say, I am your friend. Come to my table, rest here in my garden. You will you